Hi, I am Cesar Santos. I'm here at the San Diego Museum of Art. I'm so grateful for the media department that allowed me to go in the museum when the museum is closed to explore the development of principles that started during the early Renaissance and developed all the way to the 19th century and how we can use those elements in our work as artists today. Let's try to discover together if, as visual artists, we can detect elements of design such as line, value, colors, edge work, even the way application took place, and see if we can detect specific periods of art and how these elements were used in a specific way and how they evolved throughout art history all the way to the 19th century when they took the classical art to the highest level. The reason I want to start focusing with this period is just because this evolved in a very unique way during the Renaissance, during the early Renaissance, because of advancements in the northern European countries, offering the oil paints and way to mix the pigments. Also, they were gathering scientific innovations added to their art. This period was founded on the fundamentals of classical antiquity. Let's look at the lines first. Remember, line does not depend on a value. Line does not depend on color. So when I look at a painting, let's try to dissect it and just separate line first. You will see that the edges are all cut out. There is a lot of information. They haven't developed these lost and found edges yet. And you can see how everything is descriptive. We can see the flowers, all the details in the rows, the folds, the division between elements, the fingers, even the hand touching another flesh, and you can see everything delineated, divided, just as we, when we start painting, we have that tendency of drawing everything out, making sure that we have a contour throughout every aspect of the image. And we see that happening here too. All descriptive lines, everything is narrated with an outline. The amount of details is the same everywhere. All the faces take the same importance. At this time, they were still developing that element of who is the main character, who are secondary characters. We see the straight architectural line work contrasting the more lyrical curves that we see on the figure with the drapery. And this gave this sense of variation. Sometimes we just follow nature, and nature hardly has any straight lines. Everything is moving along, everything has curves. And sometimes we respond to that as artists without realizing that it's good to have that contrast. And maybe if you see a curve or a circular object, you can divide it into straighter lines to give it that strength. After all, straight lines give that dignity. Straight lines give importance. While curves are always moving, full of action, you can see the zigzagging. So you can take just the quality and the element of line and explore it in different ways and see how you can use it to be loyal to the subject matter that you're representing. So I'm gonna look to see if we can find the same thing again. When you're painting, if maybe you have that intuition in you to describe everything with the same type of line variation. So at this time, they have not developed yet the power of lost edges, the quality of the edge in a short space. That was developed by Leonardo da Vinci, and we can see in the Mona Lisa that even in a space, a very small, intricate space, maybe the bottom plane of the nose, you can see that there are sharp edges next to very smoky, soft edges right next to each other. But at this time, they're still not doing that. This is a great collection because we can have different examples of this use of the line work and see how similar it is throughout different countries, because the first painting over there was in Spain. So while in Italy, in Spain, during this period, they were just exploring with that idea edge work in that manner. Let's look at values now, because now that we have a contour, now that we have a shape created by this line work, what are the values inside of those spaces? In this period, still, the values are scattered. There is no grouping like we see in more advanced paintings that came after a couple of hundreds of years. Even in smaller paintings, there are values all around. There's not a mass of darkness that dominates the majority of the painting. We see light shapes in a dark area. We see dark values in a lighter space. And we see as we will move along and walk around how that changed dramatically just within 100 years. Even though the values within the whole painting are scattered, you can see that something happened that kept going constantly and still stayed intact until the 19th century. For instance, in each area, the values are very clean. That's something to note, because sometimes when we are painting, we tend to do these variations in an area when it's not needed. If you have a clean value in a small area, any little variation will be enough for us, for the eye, to see it, to realize what it means. But if you have an area full of little chicken scratches, then to make some information important, you have to exaggerate it. And by the time you do that, then you run out of the range of value that you can maybe use in a different area of the painting. All this information within the torso is there, but if you squint, it just becomes one clean value of that flesh color. As artists, we want to make sure that we go even to the earliest periods of art and see visually, with no information about the place, what it was done, or the artist, or the date. You just want to explore visually how we can learn about these paintings and apply it to our own practice. Here, we already seen a little bit of that aspect of grouping the values. The bottom part is all dark. Some of the light part are kind of close together, and that is in contrast to the other paintings that I was showing you that had everything more dramatic throughout. There was no real organization in terms of value arrangement. At the same time that now the values are being grouped, we see the outline disappearing too. We can realize that the edges are taking a little bit of a quality of their own, becoming softer in places, like maybe something like hair, for instance, that is a softer material wrapping around a form of the head. And that is a good moment to make those soft transitions, just to create that illusion of hair being soft. When we look at color, we realize that in general, around the whole painting, the cool colors, the blues, the greens, recede. So they are used more for further, to show distance, while warmer colors come to the front, come towards us. These are elements that become universal, and we can use it to our own advantage while we work in our studio. But if we skip this area and go maybe to a more recent period, 19th century, 18th century, we might be encountering something so advanced that it's hard for us to understand it. That's why I want to take you here and start from this early period, because we artists reflect in a way all the periods together. As soon as we start drawing as kids, we do outlines, we do very scattered values all around. And it's good to go beyond that and see our natural intuition when we come to approach in a creation of a painting. Color is good to be balanced, like I mentioned before, between straight lines and curves, or between values that are dark and are light. Well, in color, we do the same thing. You don't want to have a painting that is overwhelmingly warm, all colors red, or all colors cool. You want to have a balance. You want to have parts that are cold, blue, green, and some areas that become warmer, the red, the yellow. To offset that, we need some earth colors too. And we realize that with black and white, with that gray, we can add it to any of the colors to mute them down, so we can have some areas of rest with our eyes, because all this vibrancy of bright colors can be tiring if everything is like that. So in order for us to appreciate those high chroma notes in color, they have to be scarce. They have to be in a smaller area, in very specific areas where it's important for the story of the painting. Even in a piece like this, the whole shape of the saint is described. Every detail inside is described. Also, the values, again, are all around. The colors are changing from warm to cool. And that is also present here. About 100 years after, it's hard to find an outline. Now we don't have these descriptive shapes everywhere. There are actually a lot of detail missing in the shadow areas. So not only the edge work is taking a more advanced or developed sense where you can see them sometimes they disappear, sometimes they're sharper, sometimes they're softer, but also the values are being played with to see if we can describe the story or the image a little bit better. We can see in the lights, there is more information, more contrast. Think of those lights as the solo player in a band coming forward with the violin, and think of the shadows as the bass, keeping the notes steady. Now we are grouping things together. The background becomes the dark of the drapery, and the lights are united. So now we're separating these two families within the whole painting for us to enjoy it in a little bit more comfortable way, rather than these scattered values all around that might keep us too busy and we might miss the story. In terms of color, we have a warm color on top, leading us to find and encounter his portrait so we can have a direct relationship with him. Because if you think about it, the size of the head can get lost, because in terms of percentage, it's a very small piece, but we as humans are looking for other humans to communicate. And the moment you guide the eye, you put the red right underneath that portrait, we can find it better. We can relate to it in a more comfortable way. We have the cool colors also, as a bigger mass, and then the grays in the background. And then a little touch of yellow, because they're playing here with the triad aspect, which is a balanced triangle within the color wheel. I wanted to show you this because this is a good example of how first we have the shapes, the contour, the delineation of form, then we add value to that, and then as color comes after, we can see here that you can have a very successful painting without having too much color in it. There is a balance of temperature within areas that help out that description of form. We realize now that we have gotten rid of this marked outline, and the values are very grouped together. They're very simplified, as we saw before. A new introduction that we see here that was mastered by Van Dyck was the introduction of the light sky, the space with, normally it's done through a window. Here is done within the cave coming out. But the reason for that is to tell the story that is during the daylight. But at the same time, just for the impact of the image, we need a dark surrounding to create that drama, that contrast with the portrait, because a portrait next to a light background can be tricky. And at this time, they still didn't develop that ability to guide the eye towards a portrait when the background is light. Holbein did it in an amazing way. That was his style. But if we look at Holbein's work, you can see that he framed the portrait with a dark mass. But here, he just put the portrait, the figure, within this dark area, but hit that note of the sky behind it, just to tell the viewer that this happened during the day. The ultimate massing and grouping of light and dark in terms of value, pretty much very simple. If you look at this whole painting, you squint, you can see that all this white area is grouped together, surrounded by dark mass. If you're having this same problem to solve in your studio, you might be focusing in dark areas and adding too many accents. Make sure you keep them masked and grouped. All the information within the light areas are subtle. They're not dark enough to compete with the real grouping of those darks around it. So this is the ultimate simplification. One big light shape surrounded by a dark mass. The moment the lights are grouped together and separated in families from the darks, we can see that we feel something different that maybe we didn't feel there. Now, that might be useful to tell a story. If you want to tell a story of maybe more action, a party going on, activity, maybe it's better to scatter those values. And if you want something to have more integrity, more unification, then you group them together. The way you react to those value arrangement is gonna make you feel something different about the subject matter. Some edges are really soft, completely disappearing. We have this material in the foreground with the same kind of value and color as we have in the background. So miles away can be connected with something really close to us just by that losing that division in between. We see that happening with the shadows and the background too. He becomes the space around him because a dark area just gets connected with other dark areas around. We have the overwhelmingly brown, warm brown throughout that note of red. It's not that bright, but it's high chroma enough to represent itself and add that punch of color in the painting. For flesh color at this period, they already developed the idea that the middle of the form is the one with the highest chroma. And if it turns around, going around the form, it becomes cooler. So all around the edge is a little bit cooler than the middle of the form. And the same happens when it goes towards the shadow. Cool areas before it hits that shadow shape. This might be the ultimate compression of values. Look at the percentage of this painting that is in light. But at the same time, we don't need any more than this. Let's look at the robe here for a second that he's wearing, because we see the folds. They're visible, but they're very subtle. They still do not compete with any other values outside. And that is what I mean by grouping and keeping that integrity of the values together. So the whole background is a very clean note, a clean value that even if we made that little division in the corner there is enough to say that some light is falling on him. His face is also framed by this dark mass that gets connected with the rest of his body. And there are three points of tension here that becomes a triangle, and that is the face, the light of the paper, and the hand. And just that distance is enough to make us feel that there is nothing missing in this painting, even though it's very dark overall. The same way that each period had those characteristics, we can see here that in the middle of the 1600s, we can have very similar elements applied in the same manner. And that's why that transition takes place. Sometimes artists get too desperate to discover all these elements, while in fact, it took history of art hundreds of years to develop. This is a good example too of the middle of the 1600s. Look how soft she is around the edges of her flesh before, and the early Renaissance and the Renaissance, everything was more sharp. We couldn't imagine how we can transition those values from light to dark in such a soft way and still describe the form. As we look at the corner here, we can see a more crisp application. The edges are sharper, harder, the elements are more descriptive, but maybe the artist wanted to give that sense of otherworldliness coming from her. She's in touch with that spirit, so she's kind of evaporating. So you can use that smoky element to add another feeling to your painting. Towards the end of the 18th century, we can see that portraiture took a different route. Now we are becoming more naturalistic. We are becoming less idealized and less cartoonish, if we can say it. And we are trying to develop that aspect of the flesh colors and the human element into a more naturalistic way, a more naturalistic approach. The edge quality has evolved to this variation where you have really sharp and soft again here, that stays constant. And the value range are becoming more subtle. Now we don't have that much dramatic contrast between dark and light. Artists are learning how to simplify, how to be more subtle when describing values. So we don't have to use all these extreme notes right next to each other to give more of a pleasant and calming feeling. The cool colors in the back, the contrasting and offsetting, that red in the front calling the attention, mixed with grays and lower chroma created by those earth colors mixed within these higher chroma pigments. If a painting is surrounded by a certain type of hue, let's say in this case is blue, or that we have that cool blue color, well, the flesh is something that is higher chroma. We can add that introduction of the notes in the background in the halftones towards the shadow side. And we can realize that that's happening around the forehead and everywhere where the form is turning toward a dark area, we can add those color notes that are the same as in our surrounding. And that becomes useful because we can integrate the figure into the space. Remember, nothing can live without its environment, and you can use the colors in the environment to add it, to unify it by introducing it to the flesh colors. So don't be afraid of adding those gray colors into your higher chroma values of the flesh. We are in front of a Williams Bouguereau painting, and he took those Renaissance principles to the maximum, highest level possible, in my opinion. That's why I copied this guy more than any other artist out there. And the reason is that you can see that he was very influenced by Raphael. At the same time, he was not mimicking Raphael, he was just inspired by those principles that Raphael developed. The flow through lines, the idealization of form, bringing back those classical features and combine it in a naturalistic way with the scientific aspects of their periods and applying it to it. When we step back, we can see that the sky is the lightest thing in the painting, and her drapery kind of crosses the horizon, and everything on her drapery down is darker, and that is to unify those values. While the blouse, the white of the blouse, becomes almost the value of the sky, and that gives us room to explore that dark mass of the face in contrast with this light background. So that's another way to call the attention to the portrait, just by having it surrounded by the opposite value. The colors are very muted, but there's still balance between warms and cools. He's a master at subtlety, subtlety of line work that we describe, of edges, subtleties of value shift, how you group a dark mass with enough information so we can read into it. It's not as lost as before, but at the same time, having enough detail for us to feel those tactile sensations while looking at the painting. In order to have the hair not being the strongest thing, since hair against light, they're actually opposite and they could be calling the attention. Well, the way he solved the problem was by going around the hair and soften it, making almost solar flares around it. All right, let's wrap this video up. As I walk through the museum and see the evolution, we can use it in our work to start a revolution.